Hello friends, welcome to GYES. How are you? We hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So friends, currently we have 10 series that focus on your prelims and one series that target your mains. And also friends, let me tell you that we have also started a dedicated series that is related to your history optional. So we on this channel are also conducting the test series of history optional also. So those history optional students, those who are willing to join us, they can contact us at this contact number, that is 8968426481, or at this email ID. So let's come back to the lecture. So friends, as I have told you that daily we cover two topics, and in each topic we cover 10 to 15 MCQs. So total 30 MCQs are covered daily, 20 to 30 MCQs, and in this manner we have a kind of demarcated 10 topics which are important from your prelims point of view, like environment, science and tech, ancient India, medieval India, modern India, and in this manner others also, economy, geography, polity, so current affairs, government schemes, international relations and art and culture. So all these topics are covered by us. So what we are doing here, we have allocated each day for two topics. So in this manner we have kind of decided 10 topics to be covered, which are covered by us in 5 days in a cyclic manner. So for example today we are covering two lectures, and then tomorrow two topics, then tomorrow we will be also covering two topics, and day after tomorrow we will be covering next two topics, and in this manner the complete cycle will be completed in 5 days, and we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC 2019, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So let's start our discussion friends. So today this lecture is related to environment. So we are covering lecture number 53 of it. Already 52 lectures have been covered. So first question is, Lima Declaration is related to A, protection of biodiversity in global hotspots; B, mitigation of greenhouse gases under supplementary guidelines to the Kyoto Protocol; C, redistribution of world industry towards developing countries; D, empowering women to break the glass ceiling in the leadership of highest global institutions. So let me tell you friends that the correct answer is C, that is redistribution of world industry towards developing countries. So friends, Lima Declaration is basically related to this. It aims to redistribute the world industry in the developing countries. So the answer is C. So here is the in detail explanation. So it set the target that it would kind of strive for the redistribution of world industry by the year 2000. 25% of the industry would be coming in developing countries. So it was quite old declaration. So this is about your first question. Let's move on to the second question. The second question is, consider the following about Indian rose chestnut, also called as cobra's saffron. First, it is a tree species found in western ghats of India. Second, it is smallest tree found in hilly regions of India. Third, the tree is considered auspicious in many regions of India as it attains maturity with a full moon night. So we have to choose this statement. So please carefully note we have to consider these statements in the context of Indian rose chestnut, also called cobra's saffron. Let me tell you friends that only one statement is correct, that is first. And it is true that it is a tree species found in western ghats of India. But let me tell you friends, it is not the smallest tree. Its height is quite long. So it is quite long. So sometimes it raises to the height of 30 meter. And let me tell you friends that its growth is not overnight. It takes quite long time to grow. So third statement is also wrong. So the statement that is correct only is the first statement. So the answer is C, that is one only. So here is solution. Here is the explanation. So it is an ornament. It is widely cultivated as an ornamental due to its leaves and fragrant white flowers. And it is native to wet tropical parts of Sri Lanka, India, southern Nepal, Burma, Thailand, Indochina, the Philippines, Malaysia, Sumatra, and where it grows in evergreen forests and especially in river valleys. So this is about your second question. So friends, it is quite lengthy. It is quite large in height. So it grows it can grow over 30 meter tall and often buttressed at the base with a trunk up to 2 meter in diameter. And statement 3 is also wrong. It is a slow growing tree. So this is about your second question. Let's move on to the third question. Third question is quite easy. In India, the largest contributor to energy generation is A. Coal-based power plants, B. Nuclear plants, C. Natural gas-based plants, D. Hydro power plants. So let me tell you, friends, that in India we generate largest amount of energy by using coal-based power plants. So thermal power plants, we are still dependent upon the coal for running of our thermal power plants. So our electricity, our demand for electricity is met by these thermal power plants to a large degree, which are run by the coal. So solution is A. But let me tell you, friends, that in 2013 India became the largest producer of electricity, third largest producer, by passing the Japan and Russia, and its share was 4.8%. And India's electricity sector consumes about 72% of the coal produced in the country. So if 100 kg of coal is produced, then 72 kg is used by the electricity for producing energy. So high ash content is a problem in India's coal, and it affects the thermal power plant's potential emissions. So this causes a considerable degree of air pollution also. Let's move on to the fourth question. The fourth question is, in recent years, the population of cirrus crane has declined due to 1. Loss of wetlands and conversion of land for agriculture, 2. Collision of these birds with power lines, 3. Ingesting pesticides while foraging in the crop field. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that all of these are the correct statements. That is D, 1, 2 and 3. So cirrus crane is basically, it has seen decline in its population due to loss of wetlands and conversion of land for agriculture, and also for collision of these birds with power lines and ingesting of pesticides. So I have included also a kind of image of this bird. So it is the tallest flying bird in the world. Please note, it is the tallest flying bird, and actually its habitat is basically wetlands. So it constructs its nest in natural wetlands or in flooded paddy fields. But the main threat in India is loss of habitat and degradation due to draining of wetland as well as conversion of the land for agriculture rather than wetland. So wetlands are converted into land for agricultural usage. So for that purpose, their habitat is decreasing. So they are recently, more deaths have been reported due to their collision with the power lines. And also, friends, they are left with no choice but to forage in these fields, because as now we are currently using large number of wetlands, they are converted into agricultural land. So they are not left with no choice but to forage in these fields where the pesticides are sprayed, and they ingest those pesticides, and due to this they experience experience the decline in population. So this is the largest flying bird. So you can see here in it, it is a quite beautiful, you can say, bird. So you can see in the diagram that it basically resides in wetlands. So currently it is experiencing a huge decline in population due to habitat destruction. So let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, consider the map that shows the distribution of particular species found in India. So here is the map, friends. So you can see here, here it is given to you. So it is kind of, you can see the entire Himalayan range from Nepal to this is Uttarakhand, basically this is UP and Bihar, and this northeastern this is Western Ghats. So this is the kind of distribution of this particular species, and we have to find about which species we are talking about. A. Emerald Dove, B. Great Indian Hornbill, C. Indian Roller, D. Black-necked Crane. Let me tell you, friends, that this habitat is basically of Great Indian Hornbill. So it is basically found in these evergreen forest and moist deciduous forests of India that are found in Western Ghats and the northeastern India and in these regions, Himalayan regions. So our solution is B. So it is, let me tell you, friends, that it is mainly found in lowland forest, but sometimes it is also found up to the height of 2000 meters. So it is basically covered under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of India. So it is important statement, please note it. So, and have been declared the state bird of Arunachal Pradesh. So it is found in different areas. So let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, consider the following about the Stockholm Convention on Persistent Organic Pollutants. First, it is a legally binding document on member nations for targeting persistent organic pollutants. Second, Global Environment Facility is the designated interim financial mechanism for the Stockholm Convention. Third, the term Dirty Dozen is often associated with the convention. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that all of these statements are correct. Yes, Stockholm Convention is a legally binding instrument on member nations for targeting the persistent organic pollutants. Basically, under this, the nations who are party to this convention, they are obliged to kind of eliminate or restrict the production of certain type of pollutants which are listed under this convention. They are referred to as POPs, persistent organic pollutants, and the financial mechanism available for the Stockholm Convention is Global Environment Facility, which also acts as financial mechanism for a number of other conventions also, like Convention on Biodiversity that was signed in 1992, Rio de Janeiro. So this, let me tell you that third statement is also correct. Dirty Dozen is associated with this convention because initially it listed 12 such organic persistent organic pollutants whose production was to be limited or to be eliminated. So the solution is D. So 1, 2, 3 you can see here. I have already provided you the explanation. So this Green Environment Facility serves as financial mechanism for others, for several other mechanisms, for other conventions also, besides this your this Stockholm Convention. So Convention on Biological Diversity, UNFFC, and UNCCD. So all these conventions, they have the financial mechanism in the form of Green Environment Facility. So this is about your this statement, Global Environment Facility. So this is about your fourth or fifth question, sixth question. So let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, the objective of the Rotterdam Convention is to promote shared responsibility and cooperative efforts among parties in the international trade-off. So friends, there is a convention that is Rotterdam Convention. So Rotterdam is basically it is a city in Netherlands. So this convention was signed there, so that's why the name Rotterdam Convention. So it has been asked that it is related to the international trade in which of the following: A, hazardous chemicals; B, rare species; C, environmental antiques; D, carbon credit. Let me tell you friends that A is the correct answer, that is hazardous chemicals. So Rotterdam Convention is to promote shared responsibility and cooperative efforts among parties in the international trade of hazardous chemicals. So those members who are party to it, they are kind of they share cooperation in terms of international trade of these hazardous chemicals. For example, if a nation is producing these hazardous chemicals, then it must follow certain guidelines, and the producers in that nation must follow certain guidelines. So it is the responsibility of that nation to ensure that the producers follow those guidelines, and also it is the responsibility of that nation if it exports these hazardous chemicals to other nation, then it is the responsibility of the exporting nation to kind of providing clear information about the ill effects, about the handling of these hazardous chemicals, including the instructions on how to use it. So this is basically it regulates the international trade of hazardous chemicals. So please remember it, Rotterdam Convention. Solution is A. So already I have provided you explanations. So let's move on to the eighth question. The eighth question is, Green Imperial Pigeon is the state bird of A, Mizoram; B, Tripura; C, Jammu and Kashmir; D, Arunachal Pradesh. So friends, it is quite easy question. If you know it, then you will certainly answer it. Answer is B, Tripura. So here is the image that I have included of this bird. So this is Green Imperial Pigeon. So let's move on to the ninth question. The ninth question is, which of the following gases is the largest component of biogas? So friends, here we have been asked that biogas contains A, methane; B, hydrogen sulfide; C, nitric oxide; D, carbon dioxide. Here friends, it is asked that which of the following is the largest component. So let me tell you friends that methane is the largest component of biogas because it accounts for the 75% of the biogas. So it also has hydrogen, it also on kind of combustion it produces hydrogen sulfide also and carbon dioxide also, but methane is kind of 75% in it. So it is highly efficient fuel, excellent fuel, because it contains up to 75% methane and it burns without smoke, leaves no residue like ash and wood, charcoal and coal burning. So there are its heating capacity is high and generates the gases like methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen and hydrogen sulfide during heating. So India is rich in biomass and has a potential of 16,881 megawatt agro residues and plantations, 5,000 megawatt of this biogas cogeneration, and 2,700 megawatt of energy that could be recovered from the waste. So let's move on to the last question of today. So 10th question, consider the following statements. A, assertion, the energy pyramid of an ecosystem is always upright and narrows to the top. Reason, the biomass in the upper trophic level is very high as compared to the lower trophic levels. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you, friends, that yes, assertion is true. The energy pyramid of an ecosystem is basically upright because at each trophic level, a considerable amount of energy is lost in kind of metabolic activities as well as in the form of heat. So only 10% of the energy is transferred to the higher trophic level. So in this manner, the energy at the lower, at the highest trophic level is lowest. So in this manner, the energy goes on decreasing as we move higher in trophic level. So, but reason is not correct. It does not provide in any form the explanation, and also reason is also incorrect in itself also, because actually the biomass is a kind of a pyramid in which basically the biomass is high in lower trophic levels, leaving some aquatic food chains. So this biomass in the upper trophic levels is generally low, whereas it is high at lower trophic levels. So A is correct, R is incorrect. So the answer is D. So here is the solution, here is the justification as I provided you, told you. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you like the questions, if you like the video, please share it with your friends. Please do ensure that you like our video and also subscribe to our channel, and also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019. And let me tell you, friends, those students who want to subscribe to the PDFs of these NCQs, they can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveis21@gmail.com, or for that matter at this contact number, that is 8968426481. So this is our official number of the team achieveis. It is our WhatsApp number also. WhatsApp is available on it, and you can contact us through this number. So this is our email ID, that is achieveis21@gmail.com. So friends, in case you want to get the PDFs, you can contact us at this number. So friends, obviously let me tell you that these PDFs will be available to you at a certain cost, because but we have kept this cost as minimum as possible, so that you can afford it. But let me tell you, friends, that why these PDFs are important, because at the end of the day you will not be able to revise 15 to 20 minute long video by seeing 15 to 20 minute long video, and also you will not be able to revise by following standard books, or for that matter NCERTs, because these standard books are to be read in free time, when you have enough time for preparation, when you have to revise, when your exam is near, when your prelims is near, you must have some kind of notes from which you can revise quickly. So as you have noted in this lecture that I'm giving, we provide not only the questions and their answers, we provide the explanation also. So in this manner, you not only solve a question, you completely read a topic in a comprehensive manner, which helps in revision for the multiple times, which doesn't take place if you follow standard books from first page to last page, because this also leads to a monotonous reading. This practice becomes boring, as well as it consumes a lot of time. But with these PDFs on the answer format, in the question answer format, keeps your interest level high and helps you in revising the important concepts and important topics again and again. And in this manner, you become confident. So if you want to subscribe to these PDFs, you can contact us at this email ID, or for that matter at this contact number. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.